This is Black Agenda Radio, a weekly hour of African American political thought and action.
Welcome to the radio magazine that brings you news, commentary, and analysis from a Black Left perspective. I'm Glenn Ford, along with my co-host Nellie Bailey. Coming up, India will soon be the most populous nation in the world, but what role will it play in global affairs, and how has India figured in the African American liberation movement? And why do preachers figure so highly in the African American freedom struggle? We'll hear from the author of a new book on social gospel activism.
But first, reparations has become an issue in the race for the Democratic presidential nomination. The main organization that has kept the demand for Black American reparations alive is NCOBRA, the National Coalition of Blacks for Reparations in America, which is holding its 30th annual convention in Detroit, June 20th through the 23rd. Cam Howard is the national male co-chair of NCOBRA.
Our conference theme this year is 400 Years of Terror, Debt Still Owed. We selected that theme in conjunction with the 1619 arrival of Africans into what is then known the Virginia Colony, which began the Anglo colonization of this part of the world on this particular continent that subsequently became the United States of America. It was also a response to a bill that was introduced and passed, signed by Trump, to celebrate the 400 years of Africans being here. And we thought that it was not a time of celebration, but a reflection of the many terrors and atrocities that have happened to us in this country that have yet to be repaid or redressed. And so we selected 400 Years of Terror, A Debt Still Owed, as our theme. What we hope to accomplish this particular convention is that all of our members come away with a deeper understanding of what reparations is, according to international norms, international law, and what those outcomes, those components are of reparations, and how they can better utilize that information to make a demand for what we hope to be made whole by this country. At least they'll be able to make the demand on a more solid ground of what being made whole and repaired actually means. Secondly, we understand that this is a unique time in this country because there are two bicameral bills in Congress, H.R. 40 in the House of Representatives, the bill that has been introduced by John Conyers since 1989, and Senate Bill 1083 that was introduced in April by Senator Cory Booker. So this is the first time since Reconstruction have there been a potential for bicameral debate on the issue of redress for people of Africans in this country. So it's a very unique time for us to be organizing around reparations. And so coming out of the conference, we will unveil an action to push this legislation before full congressional discussion as well as full Senate discussion.
Yes, this is the first time in a presidential election year or season that reparations has been an issue of contention. Do you think that's a good thing? And are you comfortable with white or black presidential candidates coming up with their own proposals for black reparations?
Well, we're certainly comfortable with it being a point of distinction when it comes to a political platform that addresses people of African descent in this country. We're certainly glad that reparations is being taken seriously. Well, it hasn't been put as a plank on the Democratic Party as of yet, but it was one time before, and I think that was in 2000. It was a plank in the Democratic platform. So we're hopeful that it happens again at this particular time because now it'll be taken more seriously because there's so many people who are actually looking at this issue. I'm looking at it from a serious standpoint. We are not comfortable with white or black politicians determining what reparations is or should be, what form of redress should or should be, because we don't believe that the current political body has that particular knowledge and that they haven't spoken with people who have been engaged in this struggle for a number of years who have more of an insight of what it takes to make African people whole, to make them fully repaired. And so without any serious counsel from those of us who have been in the struggle for a long time, we don't think that anything that any of these candidates will propose will come anywhere closer reparations, anywhere closer full repair.
What do you say to Black critics of reparations, like Dr. Adolph Reed, who says that reparations is just, of course a debt is owed, but it's not going to be paid, and therefore we shouldn't be putting so much political capital and energy into it?
Well, that's one opinion. It's remarkable of how people will, after seeing a Black president, how they'll say things will not happen. And that should have silenced all of that "it'll never happen" talk. It won't happen if we don't organize and continue to put up the struggle and the demand for it. So, you know, that type of talk, I don't think a lot of people are listening. I don't think it would have much effect on the movement.
Polls show that majorities of Black folks do support reparations. Now, this conference will mark the 30th year for NCOBRA. Are you satisfied with the progress in making reparations a big issue in Black America?
I'm satisfied in the amount of conversations we're having, especially in media, in the mainstream media. We know that the mainstream media is that fourth component of the government. And when they shut an issue down, it's pretty much shut down. But there's forces that are refusing to let the mainstream media be silent on this issue or attempt to hide from this issue. And so we're satisfied in that regard that it's out there and it's continuing to get out there. And there's new articles and new pieces being distributed almost on a daily basis. So we're satisfied that this type of conversation is happening in the media, and it will lead to the conversation being had at a political level, at a policy level. And so we're happy about that.
Well, part of the conversation in the corporate media about reparations comes from those who are opposed to it and who like the idea of reparations being out there so that they can catch white candidates supporting it and oppose them because of that.
Yeah, that's one of the challenges we have when we seek political co-sponsorship on legislation, is that there will be backlash. But we're seeing that more and more, even whites are in favor of some type of redress. They just haven't defined what it is, but we're seeing more and more whites are in favor.
But do you think that it will be necessary to get majorities of white people to go along with reparations in order to achieve it?
Well, there's a new Huffington Post poll. They did one maybe 2 years ago, 3 years ago, and found out that 60% of millennials, Black, white, otherwise favored reparations. And I think they did a new one, and that number may have increased. Among white opposition, it is skewed in the age category. Age is what mostly determines white opposition to reparations. So the 50-plus, you'll find maybe, I think it was something like 13% were in favor. But as you go down to the millennials, again, it gets even higher to about 35-45% of white millennials and 60% of millennials, about 30% of white millennials and 60% of millennials across the board are in favor. So, and that's an increase. And I think that the more education that we're giving, that we're putting out here in the media and in society in general, that those numbers are going to rise, because I think that's what has made the numbers rise, that there's more people becoming aware of the legacy effect of enslavement and Jim Crow segregation on current day people of African descent. And so then they're seeing the treatment, the African-only treatment that is being exhibited in this country as well. So these things contribute to the increase of those who are in favor. And I think that the more we can educate this country, and I think that's why the commission legislation is so important, because it'll be a major educational piece for this country.
Well, what about political education within the Black community? After all, it's incumbent on Black folks to make the demand to define what reparations is, what would be a satisfactory settlement. Some of us get the impression that lots of folks think they're just talking about a check, and the debate is only about the number on the check.
Yes, we have to do a lot of education in our community because there's a lot of Blacks who are not in favor of reparations, are not in favor because they think it's just a check and that we will somehow squander the money. And so part of the education of our community, as well as, you know, white America, is that we're defining reparations as full repair. And full repair has compensation is only one component. Restitution is a larger component where the economic development initiatives, educational initiatives, community development initiatives, health initiatives, a range of other initiatives are necessary for there to be restitution. And these are forms of redress that affect the entire community or the entire body of people of African descent, as opposed to checks who may go to families or heads of household and may not be utilized in the best interest. But compensation is definitely a part of reparations. And compensation is also the biggest opposition to reparations among white Americans. They have no desire to give Africans a check. And when we focus only on a check, and NCOBRA, again, believes and knows that compensation is a part of reparations, but when we focus only on compensation, we get the biggest opposition from the white community. And it's almost like people use that in order to fire up the white community to be an opposition to reparations.
Black folks are at the bottom of the barrel of U.S. society. Is it acceptable to have a reparations that leaves Black people in that condition?
Absolutely not. We know that we would not be in that position if it wasn't for the terroristic practices of this nation over the last 400 years. We have in the past risen and developed communities, viable communities, and the only reason we're in this particular position is because of the state-sponsored violence committed against our people. And so we understand that if resources are applied to our community, we will lift ourselves up. But we still have to put in place mechanisms that halt the state-sponsored violence that has been committed and still being committed against our community. But we know that we can rise with resources directed toward specific areas like education, economic development, land, community development, health issues. We know that we can rise economically in this country with adequate resources.
But halting state-sponsored violence is not a matter of money. It's about the power, political power, to do so.
That's exactly right. So, you know, one of the things we have to do is make sure that while we're educating about the issue of reparations, we're also educating about control of our communities, state agencies, the control of state agencies by our communities, that's the police force and other agencies that have the ability to create policy that acts in a violent manner to our community. So in having control and ownership over those agencies, we can prevent those type of things from happening, like in Chicago, community control of police, Civilian Police Accountability Council, and other things like that has to be part of reparations. I just want to talk about this action that's coming out of the conference. It's NCOBRA's Legislative Action 535. And 535 represents the 535 federal legislators, 100 in the Senate and 435 in Congress. And as our goal coming out of the conference, out of the convention, is that we will interface in some fashion with every one of these legislators, either by personal visits to the office or through email, phone calls, to make sure that they are aware of this legislation and they are aware of it from this framework, that it is the first time since Reconstruction that this country has an opportunity to debate this issue of redress, whether they're for it or against it. This debate needs to take place. And we're certainly trying to get them, as many people as possible, to sponsor this legislation. And then those who do, make a position that they will argue it affirmatively on the floor once it gets to the floors. That's the action we're going to take. We're going to put all of our resources toward getting these commission legislation to their respective floors for a full debate that this whole nation can witness.
That was Tam Howard, co-chairperson of the National Coalition of Blacks for Reparations in America, speaking from Chicago.
The students, teachers, and activists of the Philadelphia Saturday Free School spent much of last year immersing themselves and the entire city in the life and works of the great scholar W.E.B. Du Bois. This time, the Free School is celebrating the year of Gandhi, the Indian activist and philosopher. Dr. Anthony Monteiro, the Du Boisian scholar, says the Saturday Free School will kick off the year-long activities at Philadelphia's Church of the Advocate on June 14th and 15th.
On the 15th, we're going to have two panels and a cultural celebration. And the first panel is entitled Hinduism, Christianity, and Islam, the Intellectual and Spiritual Lives of Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, Howard Thurman, and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And the second panel is entitled The Indian Anti-Colonial Struggle and the Black Freedom Movement and the Ongoing Problem of White Supremacy. And these panels will attempt to delve into many of the ideological and religious and political questions that confronted the anti-colonial and Black liberation movements at the middle of the 20th century in order to understand what is in fact a very similar situation, although not identical, similar situation in this moment of our history. In other words, at this time, the big problem confronting humanity is the completion of the anti-colonial struggle and the movement from colonialism and imperial domination to freedom and justice and socialism. That is as much an Indian question as it is an African question, as it is an African-American question. So that's what we're doing. For the rest of the year, we're going to have events on Paul Robeson in the anti-colonial struggle, the role of labor in the colonial and Black freedom movements. And then in October, we'll have a big celebration on the actual date of Mahatma Gandhi's birth.
Well, you certainly have a full schedule, but there's a deep void to be filled, and that includes on India. Most Americans know very little to nothing about the Indian liberation struggle or what that has to do with Black folks in the United States, except that some people do know that Dr. Martin Luther King was an admirer of Gandhi.
Yes, and you know, Americans know very little substantively about India and the anti-colonial struggle. And to be for real, most Americans, including most African Americans, do not know much substantively about the Black freedom struggle. And that's part of our problem, as you know. But of course, India is the first break with the global colonial system in the sense that the emancipation of India after a long and bitter struggle with the British weakened British colonialism, not only in Asia, but significantly its hold over Africa. And then, of course, India emerges as both a non-aligned country, a leader in the non-aligned movement, what Malcolm X called the Bandung movement, and a shining example of the transition from colonial economy to socialism. Now, of course, it is incomplete. And that's the thing I wish to emphasize, that in the 21st century, the task of humanity is to complete what was begun in the middle of the 20th century. The epoch of imperialism and the crisis of imperialism is what holds all of this together and brings it together. And you're right, Martin Luther King was an admirer of the Gandhian philosophy and method of struggle, but so was Howard Thurman. So was the president of Howard University, Mordecai Johnson. So was the courageous civil rights fighter, James Lawson. And we could go on and on and on. But so was, in a sense, Kwame Nkrumah. The influence of the anti-colonial struggle in India spread throughout the world, and it, in a lot of ways, gave hope to other peoples fighting against colonialism.
Well, what is left of Indian socialism? We just saw a big electoral victory again by Modi, the Hindu nationalist right-wing prime minister.
Yeah. And what is left is the big question, or what will be left after the second term of Modi. Modi operated within the framework of, again, what was left of the state system, regulated capitalism, if you will, or state capitalism. And so India has never experienced the kind of free market capitalism that is touted in the United States and other Western countries. It couldn't if it were to develop. Now, clearly, Modi's victory was a kind of appeal to culture and make India great again, or make India Hindu again, which is completely reactionary. But it faced a weak and weakened opposition in the Congress Party. Now, will the forces of progress and, of course, of socialism regain their footing as we go forward? That is yet to be seen. But certainly, Modi's re-election is a setback. What will be left of Indian socialism is a question. And again, if India is to be free, it will not do it and cannot do it within the fold of global capitalism. And that goes for China, and that goes for most of Africa. And that goes, again, for Afro-America as well.
Yes, and India is part of BRICS, although Modi seems somewhat uncomfortable in that position with Russia and China, South Africa, and, well, who knows if BRICS still includes Brazil.
Yeah, right. And all of those are very important questions. BRICS, in a certain way, is a manifestation of what went on in the 1950s, the rise and 60s, the rise of the non-aligned movement. However, here is the big question, and it is a geostrategic question. With the disintegration of the unipolar world and the emergence of a multipolar world where Asia is rising, indeed with all of its contradictions, but Asia is now predicted and will become the center of the global economy. And Asia is more than China. It is India. It is the Koreas. It's Vietnam and Cambodia. And in fact, it is Russia. So that creates a new context for the future of, as Du Bois called them, the darker nations of the world. So all struggles, I think, have to be historically contextualized within the framework of this new moment, this new crisis of imperialism, the inter-imperialist contradictions, i.e. America versus the European Union, England versus the European Union, and on and on and on, not to mention the contradiction between the white nations and the rest of the world, Africa and Asia in particular.
In this moment in Asia, we have, of course, the greatest public works project the world has ever seen, the Absolutely. New Silk Road, organized by China, but sending connectedness all throughout Eurasia. India's participation in that seems rather tentative. And
yes.
Also, we have the Shanghai Cooperation Agreement with Russia and China at the center, but other countries in the neighborhood also participating. And India, again, seems standoffish on that.
You're absolutely right. And the question is, how long can India resist the inevitable rise of Asia. India cannot be pro-West in an environment where all of what is significant is gravitating towards Asia. But even saying that, you know, last year, Modi and Xi Jinping, Modi, the president of India, and Xi Jinping, the president of China, met, and it was friendly, and they hearkened back to the pre-colonial, pre-European capitalist epoch when India and China were very friendly and, in fact, major trading and civilizational partners. So I think we have problems, but again, this is why we are looking to that period of the anti-colonial struggle and understanding it as unfinished business for the 21st century. We've gone through over 30 years since the collapse of the Soviet Union and the European Socialist Bloc. That was a setback, not just for European socialism and for the Soviet people, but for the world alliance against imperialism. But an important question in this time, and for us in the United States, is the question of peace and its connection to justice. And as you mentioned in one of your recent articles, you mentioned about one of the leaders of Black Lives Matter polling Black people and not asking about foreign policy or war and peace questions as they relate to Afro-America, but as they relate to Africa. And of course, that is the huge question, because to raise the question of peace is to critique and oppose your own government, your own imperialist ruling class. And hence, Gandhi becomes significant in this. But not Gandhi alone, because to fully understand Gandhi, you have to bring Martin Luther King into the discussion. And in fact, you have to bring Malcolm X into the discussion, because each of them, in their own space in time, upheld the right of nations to self-determination and to the right of nations to be free of Western and imperialist wars of aggression. And so the question of world peace as part of the issue of justice and the issue of the emancipation of Black people from racial oppression. And that is what we see going forward.
And I think at this juncture, we need to introduce a very important fact, which is that India will soon be the most populous nation in the world, overtaking China.
That's right. That's right. And the second largest economy in the world, overtaking the United States. And so in Asia, you will have at least three of the top five economies in the world. This is huge. And you mentioned the Belt and Road Initiative of China. But I think the other thing that China demonstrates, and you and I have spoken of this before, is a model of politics and economics based upon a centralization of economic and political decision making that does not put political elites against economic elites. And so the state system that exists in China, especially at this moment under the leadership of Xi Jinping, moves it not just incrementally, but I think quickly towards a socialist reorganization of the economy without intruding upon the, as we like to say in the West, the individual liberties of working people, of intellectuals, of students, and so on. I think we're looking at that model of the now time and of the future that fits the objective needs of most people in the world. And in other words, as this crisis, political crisis and economic crises of the West intensify, the model of, quote, liberal or neoliberal democracy, and I put quotes around both of those, becomes less acceptable and even less workable to solve the great problems of humanity, such as poverty, such as economic inequality, and really the question of war and peace and social justice.
Well, when we look at the two most populous nations in the world, China and India, we see a vastly different method of social organization. Yes. And anybody can see that India is in need of a revolution.
Well, yes, yes. But, you know, you're dealing with two different civilizations in many ways. China is a more monolithic civilization. Most people speak Han Chinese. Most people, in one or another way, pivot upon the ethical and moral philosophies of Confucius. In India, it's quite different. You have a vast kaleidoscope of languages. At last count, over 700 distinct languages, 25 official languages, a nation and a civilization that is so complex that to solve the immediate problems requires different methods than those that would apply in China. However, the Indian people, I think, can find pathways towards the resolution of what is, in fact, how would I put it, social, political, economic complexity on a scale that few of us are capable of even imagining, let alone find solutions to. But at this stage in human history, I would argue that China, as a social, economic, and a political system, is in the vanguard. It is pointing the way. And in many ways, India, and dare I say, we in the West, we in the United States, will have to take something out of the playbook of China.
That was Du Boisian scholar Dr. Anthony Montero speaking from Philadelphia.
The Black struggle in the United States cannot be understood without an examination of the role of ministers of the social gospel, personified in modern times by the life and work of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Gary Dorian is a professor of social ethics at Union Theological Seminary in New York City and author of the book Breaking White Supremacy, Martin Luther King Jr. and the Black Social Gospel. Professor Dorian says Dr. King's civil rights work in the 50s and 60s was rooted in previous generations of Black social gospel activism.
Well, certainly. I mean, gospel is a Christian word. This starts with Christian ministers in the era, you know, right after Reconstruction, who are just having to ask the quite terrible question, you know, what would a new abolition be now? I mean, the old abolition has come and gone. You can't just keep giving that abolitionist sermon or response to what was said in an earlier time or now in the time of Reconstruction has come and gone, and we're living into this era of American history in which things were supposed to be so much better, having gone through the Civil War and then Reconstruction and all that, and yet things are actually worse. We've got this sort of mania of lynching that is ratcheting up, and all over the South, the Reconstruction amendments are already being stolen away. So people in this situation of what is the Gilded Age, with all the sort of social dislocation and traffic into the cities and economic modernization and capitalism going corporate, while all that's going on, you have just this just terrible and I think, you know, distinct situation, especially in Black churches, of just sort of facing the terrible circumstances of the what became the early 1880s and then onward, where our figures are having to just ask this awful question of, all right, what would a new abolition be in this context? How do we conceive, construe, preach the gospel? How do we organize? How do we make an impact on society with our faith? That is the sort of orienting issue I mean, there is something distinct about the social gospel that can get ministers in trouble and that is controversial within church situations. So virtually everybody I wrote about, with one exception, the new abolition, had some sort of a battle with his own church, because arguing that the gospel has a mission to transform structures of society in the direction of social justice, that's not only controversial in the churches, it's new. The churches haven't really said that. So when you're making with that social gospel argument that indeed churches have a mission to transform social structures in the direction of something we're calling social justice, that's language that just didn't even exist before, but now it does exist, and it's controversial within churches. So all these folks, except for Alexander Walters, have a battle with their church just to establish the validity of that very thing.
You write that the founders of the NAACP wanted to call it the New Abolition Movement, but they thought better about that title, considering what impact that might have in southern chapters of the new organization.
That's right. That's how they thought of themselves. You know, you got a bunch of white liberals in there on the board, and most African Americans who were on the board were on the a little more moderate, and, you know, not the radical side. I mean, Du Bois is radical enough for that board, so just sort of dealing with Du Bois, coping with him, was enough for a number of folks there, which is why one of my favorite figures in this whole story, Reverdy Ransom, just doesn't get on the board. They've got enough trouble sort of dealing with Du Bois, and yet, with all those qualifiers that I just threw out, they all thought of themselves as new abolitionists. They're neo-abolitionists. They're the next generation of the abolition movement. That is their self-understanding. And they do believe, yeah, that would be the best name for this organization that they're creating, because that's exactly what they think it is. I mean, the Afro-American League came and went, and then the Afro-American Council was the next attempt to try to build an all-black protest organization, and then Booker T takes that over, and then the Niagara Movement. So they've had three passes at a blacks-only protest organization that deals with this, and finally, when that one is failing too, Du Bois is willing, if he has to just cut a deal with these white liberals and build something that is adequately funded and that will last and will make an impact, which is what they did. And so, you know, you have this binding together of these white liberals with folks in Du Bois' circle and beyond it. And they all thought of themselves as carrying forward the abolition struggle in the next generation in this, you know, new abolition context. But you can't call it that. I mean, they do agree that we can't call it the new abolition movement, or we'll never get a southern chapter. I mean, that's just so inherently threatening in the South that we'll just be condemned to be this northern organization if we do that. And so he ends up adopting this actually fairly clunky name that they never really thought was going to be it forevermore. They kept arguing about how should we rename this thing for years. So Du Bois is, as long as we're in this interim, whatever it is going to be, Du Bois was insistent that the color line argument be reflected in the title. And then there were others who said, well, they want advancement in there as well. So we end up with a kind of a clunky compromise of a kind of a mouthful that nobody really liked, but it's what stuck.
So how does Du Bois fit in with the social gospel aspects of your theme? Du Bois appears to many of us to be a thoroughly secular person.
Yeah, I think he's religiously musical, regardless of what's in his head about is there a God or not, or the like. I mean, the way he writes about the spiritual is the way he writes about Jesus. Du Bois has a kind of love affair, a kind of love-hate affair with the black church itself. He makes himself an expert on it. He's very, very knowing, both in his love and his criticism. And even years down the road, you know, in 1940, when he goes to Wilberforce and just, you know, blasts them for their mediocre way of appropriating Christianity and just really gives it to them between the eyes, there's a notion in there about how, you know, what would be a good way of appropriating the message of Jesus that Du Bois has always had. He had more hope of what the social gospel would become back between 1900 and 1920 than he had, of course, later on. But that notion of what it should be and could be is sprinkled all through his work. Just the fact that he and Reverdy Ransom had a cooperative relationship during the years when they created Crisis Magazine and had its spectacular run. Du Bois and Ransom were a tag team. They were sort of partners in this work. They packaged the Crisis AME Church Review as a package deal. You know, you get two for one and know about each other. So all of the ministers who are sort of black social gospel church leaders who are in that new abolition story, and then even the first half of what becomes Breaking White Supremacy, they're all in that Du Bois orbit, right? They're all sort of looking to him. And they catch the religious, the spiritual, you know, resonances in Du Bois, regardless of, you know, what he thinks about God or, you know, Christology or any such thing. So I think that Du Bois is sort of, there's a certain sort of double-mindedness on a number of topics in Du Bois, really. But with regard to this one as well, this isn't someone who doesn't get what religious people are like or how folks are motivated or even just the sheer importance of the black church to the struggle that needs to happen. Du Bois is fully there on all those things, regardless of sort of what opinion he ends up having about particular doctrines or the like.
Why didn't Ida B. Wells, the great anti-lynching fighter and journalist, why didn't she become more prominent in the NAACP?
Well, Ida Wells, that is what she wants. I mean, her whole career, she wants basically what Frances Willard has, you know, an organization that's got her back and willing to just do the work, all the tedious work that, you know, lines out speaking engagements and makes sure you can get from here to there and someone's going to welcome you when you get off of the train and so on. I mean, that she so wanted that in the 1890s. And for a little while, of course, she did have it in the Afro-American Council. I mean, they did develop a bureau, a speaking bureau, that she was the head of. And for just a little while there, she was able to get what she wanted. But then, of course, Booker T, once the Afro-American Council really became something, then Booker T's now just got to take it over. He doesn't want a protest organization. And so once it becomes the success that it was starting to become, he's just got to come in and she's not going to be in an organization with Booker T. So then she has to wait. I mean, she's kind of out on her own again for a while until they build the NAACP. And now here it does seem like this is an opportunity, another one for her. But she runs into a similar problem, although I would say even worse than what Reverdy Ransom ran into in the NAACP. And that's just within the kind of inner circle there. There's just only so much room for someone who's powerful and radical and going to make people uncomfortable and sort of push the edge of what the NAACP, you know, needs to be. And Du Bois is already all of that in those inner circles. And Du Bois himself, you know, had some pretty sharp elbows when it came to sort of competitive relationships with people, especially with women. Much as I love Du Bois and admire him, like nobody, you know, no one beyond him. This is an area in which he was competitive. He wasn't sort of generous or, you know, holding up people. And so women who sort of competed for the spotlight with him tended to get pushed out of the way. And he did do that within the early NAACP. They had a dramatic episode, right, at the founding convention, in which he tried to keep her off of the governing board. Now, she did end up getting on the board, but that didn't last long because this organization, as she said from the outset, she sees that it looks like this is being set up to be a star vehicle for Du Bois. And indeed, you know, that ended up being pretty close to the truth of what happened.
So from your analysis, it appears that it wasn't the very secular and eventually Marxist Du Bois who stood in the way or thwarted the roots of this crusading black social gospel, but the corporate allied Booker T. Washington, who was the main impediment.
Well, yeah, I line out the sort of fourfold sort of strands of the black social gospel. And the Booker T versus Du Bois argument is at the center of it. I think, firstly, I mean, there is one stream, and it's during the time of Booker T's heyday. I know it's the biggest one by far. It's because Booker T. Washington himself is, you know, it is one plausible, certainly powerful version of a social gospel argument. Now, here you're pulling way back on a social justice claim per se, certainly any kind of protest activism. Although even there, you know, there's other stuff going on. I mean, there's stuff behind the scenes, under the table. I mean, Booker T is a savvy, canny, wily political operator. And so he's doing certain things very much in public. And then another, you know, in other contexts, he's actually, you know, he and Du Bois are working together. And Du Bois knows all that. That's when, even when Booker T gave the Great Accommodation speech in 1895, Du Bois early on said, hey, you know, it's plausible. It's maybe that will work. Nothing else is working. And meanwhile, in the Deep South, you're just threatened with death every day that you protest anything. There is one of this black social gospel strains is the Booker T tradition, which has a lot of church leaders in it. But of course, then that argument gets joined between Booker T and Du Bois. And so that protest wing that does runs through Niagara and runs through the NACP and through the other sort of organizations I sort of map out in these books, that's the second one. And then there's a nationalist tradition in the black social gospel, both in the narrow sense and more broadly. I think conceiving black nationalism more broadly, virtually everybody in this tradition has got some nationalist strain, you know, to some degree. There's almost nobody who has none of it at all. Pauli Murray would be an example, someone who really doesn't have any of that.
Give us some examples of the black nationalist strain of this tradition.
Oh, certainly. Well, Henry McNeil Turner is the militant, and he's not just black nationalist in the cultural sense, to say African-Americans have a sort of distinct culture or even another nation within living within this hostile nation. Almost everybody in my story has got some degree of arguing that. But of course, Turner himself is one of the leading figures in Back to Africa. And he goes to Liberia and preaches for most of his career that African-Americans to have no real future in this hostile, just unremittingly white supremacist and racist society, and that the only real hope is to build an African-American empire in, or at least nation, but really empire in somewhere in West Africa. So, of course, Alexander Crummell is similar. I mean, he made a similar kind of argument for the first half of his career. And, of course, in his case, he was a missionary in Liberia for some time. But when Crummell comes back to the U.S., basically after he gets sort of kicked out, he's still a cultural nationalist, but he has sort of given up on that sort of Back to Africa movement. So there's all kinds of room within this category for, you know, more narrowly or more broadly. Ida Wells, too. You know, Ida Wells has a very strong, I mean, it's hard to miss, even though I would put her more in the Du Bois wing of it in terms of how all the arguments work out. There's a strong core of a deep sort of black identity, black nationalist sentiment sort of drive in her. That is one of the lines, the black nationalist. And then the fourth one is people like Adam Clayton Powell Sr., and they just need to have it both ways between Du Bois and Washington. You know, Washington's got his good points, and Du Bois has his good points. And really, we've got both of these traditions within congregations, so we've got to be able to get along and kind of row with two oars. So there are plenty of folks who make a kind of both-and argument with regard to Du Bois and Washington, though, of course, over time, as you move through their 20th century, that Washington strain sort of thins out as Du Bois so clearly sort of won this argument.
Today, most people would associate the term black social gospel with Dr. Martin Luther King, and many see the civil rights movement as being a largely church-saturated enterprise. But Dr. King was in fact shut out of most southern cities during the 60s because he couldn't get a fellow black Baptist congregation to invite him in.
Yes, well, this helps to sort of make the point that there is something distinct about the social gospel. I mean, I think virtually are vehicles of surviving this just relentlessly hostile white supremacist society. So there's always, in all these sort of black church traditions, some ethic of dealing with, coping with a dominant and hostile white society. That's just baked in. In that respect, there's always some kind of social dimension to, I think, black churches forming that is different than a lot of white churches that really are just a kind of religious individualism, and church is just what you do on Sunday and the like. Having said that, there is something really sort of distinctive being claimed in the social gospel, that the church is supposed to be doing the work of social justice. And a lot of church traditions just don't want to hear that. They just want to think of the church as a vehicle of survival and of a consolation and hope in heaven, and just preach that, and don't be telling me all this mess about how we need to change society and the like and get us in trouble, especially in trouble with white people and so on. So everybody, Alexander Walters was the only person I had in New Abolition who doesn't have this battle with his own church. So King knows about these folks. In fact, the people who are his mentors, the people that he's picturing, since he had himself had no activist background at all when lightning strikes in Montgomery, what he's having to do is just picture in his own head, sort of channeling what Benjamin Mays would have said in this circumstance, what Mordecai Johnson would be doing, would be saying in this situation that has bloomed. So the fact that there is a sort of black social gospel tradition that says, yes, indeed, social justice is the business of the church, is in his head and in his heart. He believed that before he got to Montgomery, and it made him ready. It prepared him in a way he in some ways didn't realize, but it prepared him for the role that he played. But as you say, yes, he's in the Baptist convention that he is in. He's in a battle with that denomination at the national level. Right up till 1962, the church itself is not, it's against the civil rights movement. It's only ever a minority of churches who got into it. When they did the great demonstration in Birmingham, King expected to get arrested early on, but then they had to stay out because they're having to, in those rallies every night, they're just pleading. You've got this fantastic preaching going on that's just trying to build up the number of people who are willing to get arrested the next day, because the numbers are always much lower than what they thought they were going to be dealing with coming in. They have 225 African-American pastors in that area, and only 25 of them were ever part of the Birmingham demonstrations. So he's struggling with that fact all along. Now, one side of that struggle is that he's going to leave in a couple of months, but you know, meanwhile, they're still going to be living there, and they have to fear that the revenge, the sheer vengeance that could be visited on them, you know, once the demonstrations are over, could be quite vicious, as of course it turned out to be before the demonstrations were even over. People were getting their homes bombed and people getting killed with the police just still wilding in the streets. So we saw a fair amount of that come to be before the Birmingham demonstration was even over. So when he had that interview with Alex Haley in 1964, you know, Haley asks him about this social gospel thing, and King sort of lays out the whole argument, and Haley comes back and says, well, do black churches do any better at being faithful to the social gospel, as you call it, than white churches? I mean, we've just established that white churches aren't faithful to it. Are black churches doing any better? And it's the one time in that interview that King kind of hedged a little bit. He kind of leaned on saying no, but then, you know, quickly comes back to saying, yes, it is always difficult to get ministers to be out in the streets, to be part of protests that they didn't organize and that do somewhat go against the grain of a kind of the ethos of the church. But nonetheless, you just cannot compare the white church situation and the black church situation, since in black churches, this is just up against it and endangered all the time by this. There are reasons why it's so hard to mobilize black churches in protest struggles, or as white churches. They've got no excuse whatsoever.
Well, in fact, the black church did play a political role, that of accommodation, and in that sense was much more in line with the legacy of Booker T.
Well, there's no question there's an awful lot of that. in black churches, and that, of course, is exactly what King is having to overcome. Southern Christian Leadership Conference is all about needing to sort of light a fire, to be this sort of outfit that, you know, runs to places in order to just cause disruption, just expose the sheer hostility, the violent sort of racism that is just underneath the surface of white America, wherever you look. And yes, they're inclined to find just the ugliest places they can in order to sort of dramatize it. But this is always a problem. Wherever the SCLC goes, they're always trying to bring more church people into the struggle than they're ever able to. But that was the work.
And that's it for this edition of Black Agenda Radio. Be sure to visit us at blackagendareport.com, where you will find a new and provocative issue each Wednesday. That's www.blackagendareport.com. It's the place for news, commentary, and analysis from the Black left. I'm Nellie Bailey, along with my co-host, Glenn Ford. Our thanks to the good people at the Progressive Radio Network.